Gibbons, your MLS director for Southwest MLS, and for this video, I want to go over some of our rule changes that are going into effect on August 1st. Now, real quickly, I've already covered the minimum photos rule and the document enforcement rules that are changing August 1st in previous videos. Those will be linked in the description of this video, so if you need those, go follow those links. This video is going to be covering all the other stuff. So let me get my screen pulled up here for you, and the first thing you'll notice is that the rules look significantly different. We went through and did a total refresh of the rules to make them significantly easier to read and a lot easier to find what you need. So when you get down here, you'll see that first off is a quick reference for frequently asked questions that we get the rules, such as trade cooperation, required documents, voter requirements, so on and so forth. There's also a full table of contents with every single section name or section title on there for you. And then you'll notice that when you get down to the actual rules, they're, again, significantly easier to read. So that was one update we wanted for the members to make it where it's not quite so hard to find all the information you need in the rules. So now to kind of go through and show you some of the changes that have happened to talk about. First off, we've added a definition of a bedroom. And the reason for this is if a house is listed as a four bedroom, but you go there and in your opinion, it's only a three bedroom, and you send it into compliance, we didn't have anything to base that on. It was just broker's opinion on whatever we thought it was. So the MLS definition of a bedroom is that it must have at least a minimum of a door, one other form of egress to the outside of the building, usually a window, and it has to be 70 square foot minimum. And square footage with the ceiling height less than 5 feet does not count towards this minimum. And an important extra, a closet is not required to be considered a bedroom. So this helps us have compliance on our bedroom data and keep a much more accurate count for you. Now, the next, really the rest of them are all things that actually came down from NAR. They were all requirements of things that we had to add to the rules because of some changes that are going on at NAR. A lot of these rule changes are part of the DOJ agreement that was backed out on, and you can of course refer to NAR for any questions on that, but these are things that we wanted to go ahead and implement anyways. So the first one actually I'm going to talk about is this one here, that participants and subscribers can receive no more than three administrative sanctions in a calendar year before they are required to attend a hearing for their actions and potential violations of MLS rules. Now, there'll be some more information on this coming soon, but essentially what this means is if you get three or more administrative sanctions or four or more fines related to listing data, you and your participant, or your qualifying broker, will be required to attend a hearing of the compliance committee to determine if additional sanctions are needed. So that's a really good way to curb people who like to, you know, pay a fine as a cost of doing business, right? Because at a certain point, you have to attend this hearing, and the compliance committee can make a decision to impose additional sanctions. Another one to talk about is the services advertised as free. MLS participants and subscribers must not represent that their brokerage services to a client or customer are free or available at no cost to their clients. So the key here is brokerage services. The number one question I get on this is, oh, can I still offer free CMAs? Or, oh, can I still offer free listing advice? Or free listing presentations? Of course, those are all things you can still offer to customers as free. What NAR is trying to curb is saying things like, hey, my services are free to the buyer's agent. Because they're not. You are getting paid by the seller. So anything that you are receiving financial compensation for, you should not advertise to clients as free or available at no cost. That's the major difference there. Another big change in NAR policy, and these next two, next three, all deal with IDX rules. So if you have an IDX website, these apply to you. If you don't have one, you can probably stop watching here, but it's still good to know that these things are coming. So the first one is that IDX websites now must have the option of displaying cooperative compensation from the broker. So The MLS has to provide this data to MLS websites. It is still up to you as the broker or customer of the website whether you want to display them or not. It will be available in MLS data. So if you want to display that, then talk with your vendor and they can help you get that turned on. But the MLS has to make it available now. So our rules have been updated to reflect that. Another one is that the MLS can no longer prohibit the display of sold listings. The only thing that we can prohibit the display of now is sold price. So that has also been updated to reflect in the MLS rules. Finally is broker attribution. So this is a new rule, and this doesn't actually go into effect until September 1st, but we wanted to go ahead and make the update in our rule all at the same time, that all IDX listings have to display the listing firm and the email or phone number provided by the listing participant. So this is a major change, because previously within IDX, you only had to display the listing firm. Now you must also display the email or phone number provided by the listing participant. Like I said, this doesn't actually go into effect from NAR until September 1st, so we just wanted to go ahead and get it in our rules while we're making all these changes at once. And there will be more information coming on this about how the listing participant, which is the qualifying broker, can choose the email or phone number that is selected. So keep an eye up for that, more information on that coming in the future. So, like I said, this is just a lot of little changes that are going on. There's even more changes if you go through the whole red line, but those are the ones that actually affect the way our business is run on a day-to-day basis. There were a couple other changes, such as things like your listing data must be accurate, contact information can't be available in public fields, property address is a required field, and that we have to accept anonymous complaints. And those are a mixture of things that were either updated just to more accurately reflect what we're already doing, or in the case of anonymous complaint, came down from NAR. But they didn't significantly change anything about the way our business is happening, so I don't need to belabor those in a video. However, you're of course welcome to review those in the red line to see all the changes that have happened. That's really about it. That's